Body surfing.
Okay, then yeah.
Johnny up.
Hi. Good evening. I'm Pat McCarthy, longtime NAR member, been in since probably the early 70s or so, and flying competitively mostly since then. Been lucky enough to be working out at Cape Canaveral or Kennedy Space Center for my whole career. I went to Curtin Aeronautical University in Daytona Beach, graduated there, went to work for Grumman Technical Services at the Cape, and then a couple years later went to So after working for Grumman for a couple of years, went to work for Computer Sciences Raytheon, which was the range instrumentation contractor at the Air Force Eastern Range. For the past 10 years, I've been working for Space Florida, which is a economic aerospace development organization for the state of Florida. So I've been lucky enough to be working at the KSC of the Cape all those years, so probably seen 600 and some launches or so, either from, you know, my backyard or my front yard, or going outside the office and watching things. I've been lucky enough to see a lot of stuff that's going on at the Cape, and want to talk to you a little bit about what's coming up, why things are changing in the past couple of years, and where we think things are going. So here's what we're going to talk about. Do real quick history, where I think things are going, and just give me the official disclaimer, none of this is related to Space Florida, or the state of Florida, or Governor Rick Scott of the state of Florida. So, you know, it's strictly my opinion. So I like to think I have some informed opinion, but it's strictly my opinion and not related to where I work. See what kinds of things are changing. Talk a little bit about all the different vehicles and facilities and payloads that we're going to be flying. You know, most of you are probably pretty familiar with the Cape. We've flown since 1950, first bumper launch there in July of 1950. And since then, we've flown over 34 different launches from the Cape and just offshore. That counts an awful lot of sub-launched ballistic missiles as well, but they're all launched from the Eastern Range, which is run from the Cape. Obviously, we've flown a huge mix of different kinds of launch vehicles out there, as well as every U.S. crewed flight has flown from the Cape Spaceport, either Cape Canaveral or Kennedy Space Center. So what's coming up, and where do we think things are going? If you take a look at this graph, this is the American commercial launch market and the share of it that the United States has had. The red line is the shows how many commercial launches have happened on United States boosters. You'll notice that back in the 80s, or rather in the early 1980s, we pretty much controlled the market. After that, the Russians started to throw their boosters into the mix and sell them. And along came the Chinese, the Indians, the Japanese, Sea Launch, a couple other private companies that were formed from foreign entities, and they pretty much took our market share away. If you look here in 2009-2010, we had zero commercial launches from the United States on United States boosters. So things are starting to turn around because we have people like SpaceX is starting to make their mark and sell a lot of commercial flights, as well as folks like United Launch Alliance trying to restructure some of their operations and get more commercial stuff back in from U.S. shores. Things are changing a lot. The whole space industry is changing. Government budgets are getting a lot smaller, and you know, things like sequestration are taking away a lot of the oomph that government launchers used to have. The budgets are getting smaller for all government space activity, and it's making a transition or a shift over to commercial. You know, obviously NASA and U.S. government are starting to purchase a lot of commercial services, pretty much turnkey operations. They'll give a satellite to a company like SpaceX, United Launch Alliance, and say, put this in orbit for me, and it's a commercial contract. It's not, it has some NASA oversight, but it's run by a commercial company under commercial rules, and the FAA Office of Commercial Space are the folks that are responsible for that. So that means government reliance on private industry is really starting to increase. Also, the whole global space industry revenue stream, most of that, always been, like say the last 10 years, it's been more from commercial side than it is from government. So you're going to see a lot more of that in the future. Then again, we've heard some of this before, right? And now we're coming up with, people are saying we're going to have all these gigantic satellite constellations, right? Who remembers something called Teledesic? We remember something, well, Iridium is up there, and they've got, what, 80 or 90 satellites. Teledesic was going to be on the order of 400. Well, now we've got OneWeb. They're saying they're going to launch 700 satellites. And SpaceX says they're going to put up 4,000 satellites. And these are all to provide broadband internet service to people around the globe. So that means, obviously, you're going to have to have a lot more launches to support all these satellites up there and keep replacing them on a regular basis. Just to say, you know, it has happened before and that market never materialized. Whether or not we're going to see a 4,000 satellite constellation remains to be seen. The earlier ones like Teledesic and Iridium, they were almost there, but then something called fiber optics came along and people found out it was cheaper to lay fiber optic cable on the ground. It was easier to put in place and to maintain than it was to put a satellite up. And that pretty much pulled the rug out from underneath somebody like Teledesic. Now these other ones are trying to bring internet service to places where they have almost zero ground infrastructure, like Africa, South America, where you have people that have no internet connectivity at all. But if you can beam it down from a satellite in low Earth orbit, then you're only going to need a small handheld terminal. It's going to look a lot like a cell phone. So now we're going out for business. Not out of business, but out for business. The government obviously can't afford to maintain a lot of things that they used to have. There are something on the order of 8,000 different buildings on Kennedy Space Center that used to be related to the space shuttle program. When that stopped in 2011, they said, well, you know, we can't really afford to keep all these facilities in operation. So what are we going to do? Start to give them away to commercial industry. Complex 39A has been leased to SpaceX. They've got like a 40-year lease. So it used to be a former space shuttle launch pad. You can see it in the background here. SpaceX has put up this gigantic new hangar, which is about the size of a soccer pitch, to do their Falcon Heavy and other boosters from there. Complex 36 out on the tip of the Cape used to be an Atlas Centaur launch pad. There used to be a pair of them. That and Complex 11 immediately to the north are going to Blue Origin. Space Florida, my organization, has got Complex 46, used to be for launching Trident ballistic missiles and Athenas. And now we're converting it over to launch Minotaurs and other vehicles. We'll talk about that later. The shuttle landing facility runway, NASA said, we can't afford the $1.5 million a year to operate it. They turned it over to the state of Florida, and now we're operating it as a commercial facility. I'll talk more about that in a little bit, too. The idea is Air Force and NASA can't afford things. They're starting to give them away to commercial industry. You want an order processing facility? I can sell you. OPF 1 and 2, which were originally built at the beginning of the space shuttle program, now Boeing has moved in there to fly the Air Force X-37B. So they've taken over both of them. OPF 3, which was built later on in the shuttle program, has now been turned over to Boeing for their CST-100 Starliner. So they went in, completely gutted all three of those buildings, took out all the shuttle era equipment because space shuttle orbiters required massive work platforms that completely surrounded the vehicle. When it was in the hangar, you couldn't even tell there was a space shuttle in there. It was so enclosed by GSE that you couldn't even get to see it. You know, we'd walk right underneath one and you wouldn't know it because there were platforms everywhere. You know, they're changing out the 40,000 tiles on the orbiter, so it was tons and tons of stuff. All that has come out, and now Boeing in OPF-3 has turned it into their Starliner final production facility. So they're taking their capsules and putting them together there. Service module and command module, and they're going to be flying. I'll talk a little bit about that later on as well, but they're going to be flying maybe next year. But they're in the middle of initial production right now. Complex 39A, I mentioned that SpaceX had taken that over. In the good old days, Saturn and shuttle days, you had this gigantic flame trench, right, lined with fire brick and everything. And I just throw a picture of me and say, yeah, I managed to get there one time. Like I say, I've had a lucky working in different places. Now, SpaceX has put in like the biggest piece of concrete that I've ever seen, and it fills up the whole south end of the flame trench, and they've got two rail sets on either side of the flame trench, and these gigantic hydraulic pistons here. They take the transporter erector fixture, stack their rocket on top of it in that big hangar that was down at the base of the ramp on 39A, roll it out to the pad, hook up these hydraulic cylinders, and raise the rocket up to vertical over the flame duct. And now all the flame's going to come out the north end and the south end. Strangely enough, they had to build this just because they use a big aircraft tug to push the transporter erector out from the integration building out to the launch pad. But they couldn't, for some reason, they didn't want to do two tugs, one on either side, because it was hard to keep them pushing at the same speed. So they just put one, but they had to add this gigantic place for the tug to roll it out. Now they're going to be flying their crewed mission for Dragon and Falcon Heavy off of 39A. And, you know, they said that was going to happen in 2013. So maybe we're going to see it this year. Right now it's on the schedule for first Falcon Heavy is November of this year. But I'll believe that when I see it. And you want a new launch pad? Well, people are planning to put them in a couple of different places. Complex 48, Complex 49, a place called Shiloh. These are all just artist conceptions of various new launch facilities you might see, all commercially operated for commercial vehicles. This one is just south of the shuttle pads, called, we're calling it like 49, or maybe that one's 48. There's another one called 49, which is north of the shuttle pads. This one's called Shiloh, which is on the way north end of Merritt Island. And here's where they may end up. So the state of Florida is working to build Shiloh, which is brand new and all greenfield site. 49 might be north of the former shuttle pads here at 38 and 39. 48 is between the shuttle pads and the Atlas V pad. And of course, SpaceX is flying from 40. ULA is flying in the Delta IV from 37. Blue Origin, I'll talk about them a little bit more as well. They've taken over 36, and of course, Space Florida is flying from 46. If you came to NARCON 2014, we met the first night Friday right outside of the gate of the Air Force Station there at Port Canaveral. Shuttle landing facility came over to Space Florida last June, and now it's a registered Florida private use airport. Doesn't mean you can take your Cessna and fly in there, although if you had a space-related project, you could fly your private aircraft in there. Right now we're seeing things like the Antonovs and the C-5s that bring in rocket parts from Denver or from Decatur. They'll bring in, and SpaceX is not flying in anything except satellites and things in there, but you'll see these big aircraft bringing in rocket and payload pieces. Let's see, about 2 weeks ago they brought in the first Orion capsule pressure vessel, which is going into the Neil Armstrong operations and checkout building on KSC. So they're building that up for its first real flight. They had that exploration test flight a couple years ago. What are the kinds of things we're going to do out there? Obviously space-related things, space tourism maybe. We'll see some horizontal takeoff things. I'll talk about that a little bit later. Maybe, you know, the Virgin Galactic type.
Has X-Corps folks talked to you guys at all?
Sorry?
Can you say if X-Corps has talked to you?
Yes, they have, and I'll mention them a little bit too. We're talking to them about putting up a hangar out at the shuttle runway as well. Other aerospace R&D, there's a lot of folks that want to do aerodynamic testing and things like that. When you have a three-mile-long runway, it makes it a lot easier for people to fly airplanes. You know, you can take off and land three or four times in some aircraft. Autonomous vehicles, drones, if you will, UAVs, UASs. This is in controlled airspace, restricted airspace, so it makes it very easy. You can take off and be immediately in restricted airspace. You can go supersonic pretty much immediately off the beach because there's no population anywhere near the, no public anyway, anywhere near the shuttle runway. going to do things like high energy testing, like shooting lasers up and down the runway as well. Because it's extremely flat. You can, except for the curvature of the Earth, you can go from one end of the runway 3 miles down to the other end. There's only 1 inch difference across that entire length of the runway. It was built so well and so flat. Because when they built it back in the mid-70s, when they were planning the space shuttle, they didn't really know how big they needed it to make it. They weren't sure how long it would take to land the shuttle because they were still playing with the designs at the time. So they said, let's make it 3 miles long and put a 1,000-foot overrun on either end. And they did, but then after the shuttle got built, they found out, well, they could land it in 10,000 feet. So they never really used the entire runway for shuttle flights. But for something like Steve Fawcett flew his unrefueled around-the-world flight nonstop, he took off from this runway and flew around, and he didn't come back here, but he made it all the way around the world and flew the entire circumference of the Earth. But he had to leave from here, and he used 14,000 feet of the 15,000-foot runway. So you know, there are some aerodynamic folks that love to use this. And we're doing other fun things out there as well. Last week we had the Andretti Racing, Indy Racing team out there, and they were zipping up and down the runway, and they put sensors and telemetry things all along the side of the runway, and they were doing, I don't know, 180, 190 miles an hour. And I was out there touring some folks, and we were driving along in our little minivan, you know, and we were listening on the radio, and they say, oh, Andretti's making a run. It's like, okay, there he went. And then you see him turn around at the other end, and whoop, he goes back. So we're renting out the runway to some things that are not necessarily space related. All right, so let's go into some of the rockets and payloads and everything else. This is just a short list. I mean, there's a lot of other stuff that might be going on. These are the ones that have been talked about publicly, so I can mention that. We've still got a few other projects we're doing that are sort of under the radar, and I've got non-disclosure agreements. I can't talk about everything. I can make some hints though. NASA Space Launch System, first launch of this might be in 2018. Looks like they're getting there. They're building the parts. This is going to have 4 RS-25s, which are basically space shuttle main engines, and then 2 5-segment solid rocket boosters on the space shuttle. They had 4-segment boosters. Now they're going to 5-segment, and these are all composite filament wound casings, so they're a lot lighter, even because they're not steel casings. And then this is going to fly from 39B. They pretty much took down all the existing shuttle hardware. It's a clean pad. They roll it out on a new launch platform with the crawler transport. But it's going to look like a Saturn V. You know, some of the earlier incarnations of pictures they showed, it was painted black and white. Like, you know, real rockets should be black with, or white with black roll patterns on, right?
Oh, okay.
Now, of course, they said, well, wait a minute. That's going to add, 4,000 pounds of paint. Just like, you remember, a shuttle used to have a white tank. And then they said, let's save the weight. Let's, just leave it the original insulation foam cover. So I think SLS will see that. The thing about this is, it's only scheduled to fly like once every 2 years. It's not, it's not a Saturn that you could fly twice a year. It's not a shuttle that you could fly 3 or 4 or 5 times a year. So it's going to be kind of a difficult program, I think, to keep going with Congress, because it's not going to have a lot of oomph if you only fly every 2 years. And what do you do with your launch crews? You know, how do you keep them trained and current on things if you only fly once every 2 years? I mean, yeah, you can do simulations, but it's not the same as doing the real thing. So
why is it scheduled that way? I mean, what's the point?
Because they don't have a huge bucket of funding to keep it going, I think. And
Mars.
That's the idea, is that eventually it would do Mars missions. It can loft, it's a Saturn V class, 70 metric tons or so, and then there's growth versions that'll do 120 tons. So you can get some big payloads up there, but right now, other than Orion and the asteroid rendezvous mission, there really isn't much that NASA's got on the table. They're saying, well, we're going to build this rocket, and they're sort of working to find missions for it. And, there are some folks that joke that SLS, actually stands for Senate Launch System, because the Senate and the Congress said, you must build this rocket. You need to have a big rocket. Now, whether or not this is going to continue to fly, I think remains to be seen.
That does, and interestingly enough, match up with Congress's two-year sessions.
Yeah, that's true. So they're going to fly Orion, the Orion capsule on this. It's got a really crew, and this is part of what NASA calls their mission to Mars. And one of the first missions they're going to fly is to do a very high Earth orbit, or go out to one of the Lagrange points and come back. And there's another one where they're going to use a robotic vehicle to retrieve a asteroid and bring it into a high Earth orbit, and then send the Orion out to rendezvous with it, and they can bring samples back.
High Earth or high lunar?
Excuse me?
It's Earth orbit or a lunar orbit?
Well, it's sort of cislunar. It's not going to. Oh. They are going to fly some lunar missions as well eventually, but right now it looks like they're going to go around the moon and back.
I thought the asteroid folks were worried that people talked about, well, that's an asteroid orbiting Earth. That could be dangerous.
Yeah, well, orbiting moon, not too bad. Yeah, that'll make some folks nervous, that's for sure. But Orion's being built now at Kennedy Space Center, and they flew one mission with the test vehicle in December of 2014, and then the first mission with this is supposed to be in 2018. That would be uncrewed, and then 2021, 2022 timeframe, and they'll start flying crews on Orion atop an SLS. So one of the neat things they're doing with it, and I'm doing a little bit of work with these folks, is the Ascent Abort Mission, or AA2. This is a high-altitude abort to test out the Launch Escape System rocket on top of the Orion capsule. So the only bad thing about this is Little Joe 1, fins. Little Joe 2, fins. This would be Little Joe 3, no fins. I mean, that's the vehicle there. This is sitting on a launch stand. So it's a Orion capsule surrounded by its ogive cover with the launch escape system, the launch abort rocket on top of it. And underneath, they put the first stage of a Peacekeeper motor, an SR-118 Peacekeeper solid rocket motor. These tuna cans around the outside, which mimic the diameter of the SLS adapter that sits on top of the SLS rocket, to look like that from the outside. On top of the Peacekeeper motor, they put the guidance assembly and a thrust reaction structure, and then they stack something on the order of 250,000 pounds of ballast on top of it, because the Peacekeeper motor's got such high performance. It was meant to shoot an ICBM off, you know, at 12 Gs or so. Well, you're not going to do that with an Orion capsule. So they put all this ballast to weigh it down so it doesn't go quite so bad. The idea is to fly this up to about 40 to 50,000 feet, get up to the test condition they want, where the aerodynamics, you know, it's near max Q, and fire the escape rocket, pulling the capsule away, separate the capsule from the escape rocket, and then let it land in the ocean. No parachutes, because they're trying to save money on this mission, so they're just dumping everything in the water. So, that's another one of those NASA budget things. Like, when we originally started talking to
bake sale for
NASA, they're going to fly this off Complex 46, and Space Florida is running that pad now. So, we talked to them beginning in about 2010. It was going to be a full-up flight. They were going to separate the capsule, drop the parachutes out, go recover it. And they were talking about reflying the Orion that flew on the EFT-1 mission in December of 2014. But then they said, well, maybe we want to fly that capsule on the first Orion flight or something. And then they said, well, no, we're not going to refly that one at all. We're going to fly basically a boilerplate on the AA-2 mission. And then we said, well, are you going to fly parachutes? And they just said, no, we don't have the budget for that either. So last May or so, they decided they were just going to dump everything in the water after the flight. It does test the capsule and escape system at the aerodynamic conditions that they want. It's going to be near max Q at 40 to 50,000 feet. And it's going to end up about 10 miles offshore. But it all ends up in the water. So everything's telemetered back, which is okay. They can get the data that way. But, if I was an astronaut, it's nice to see parachute, capsules pushed out of the back of a C-130 or C-17. You test the parachutes from, 15,000 feet. Okay, they work. It lands nice and soft. But if I was an astronaut, I'd like to see this escape system work from start to finish. Show it off the pad, get it up to max Q, separate from the escape tower, pop the parachutes and land softly in the ocean, I probably feel a little bit better than just saying, trust us, it'll work. We've tested the parachutes here, we've tested the escape rocket, we're pretty sure when we put them together, it'll all work fine. Who else is flying? Of course, United Launch Alliance is going to keep going with Atlas V's and Delta IVs, although in the future, you're not going to see the single stick Delta IVs. They're like the most expensive booster in the U.S. inventory right now. But they are going to continue to fly Delta IV heavies. You'll see those out of Vandenberg as well as the Cape. Atlas V is going to continue to fly their different variants with and without solids. You know, they're flying, they just finished flying the last of the GPS 2F series on the single stick Atlas V, and they're going to transition to, some of those are going to fly in SpaceX Falcons now, and in the future you'll see a couple more of those. The heavy versions of the Atlas V, 551s that have the five solids on them, you'll still see those flying some of the larger DoD communication satellites. ULA is gonna switch over in the next few years to what they're calling the Vulcan rocket. It's a, you can't really call it a follow-on to an Atlas V. It's got some similar elements, but they're building a brand new first stage booster for it. The solids will be similar to what they're flying in Atlas V now. The booster, they're planning to reuse. They're gonna buy their engines from Blue Origin. They're called BE4, they're LOX methane booster as opposed to the LOX RP1 that they're flying now. And the idea is that they're only going to save the engine compartment. Drop it off after you stage, and it's got a Centaur stage which goes on into orbit. They're going to drop the engine package on the first stage, use an inflatable aerodynamic decelerator so it'll re-enter the atmosphere, pop out a parafoil parachute, and then use the helicopter to come along and snag it and bring the engines back. So it's very similar if you were at the, well, the Air Force Museum doesn't have the C-119 out in the regular display now. We went on the behind the scenes tour the other day, and the C-119, that was the first one to capture a returning film capsule from spy satellite, is being reworked. So it's a similar concept. You know, for years we retrieved film capsules from reconnaissance satellites by snagging them over the Pacific Ocean. You know, you fly an aircraft along, and things come down under a parachute, and you manage to grab it. So similar kind of thing, except they're using parafoil so they can steer it a little bit and hopefully make it easier for a helicopter to go out the 100 miles or so offshore and scoop it up as it's flying back after it re-enters the atmosphere. And, you know, they've got the numbers here that say, well, you know, engines are 25% of the cost of the booster, or 65% of the booster cost, and we're going to lower the cost overall by 90% because we're going to be reusing the most complicated piece is all the turbo machinery and the engines on board the vehicle. So that's going to be interesting to see. And right now, that engine's being developed, the VE4 engine's being developed by Blue Origin, and they haven't tested these yet. It's probably another 2 to 3 years yet before we'll see those engines in operation. SpaceX, of course, you know, makes a lot of news. They're doing okay, trying to refly their Falcon 9 boosters. There's been no identical configuration flown on any of the Falcon 9 so far. Every single mission that they've flown with the Falcon 9, and they're up to what, like 14 or 15? There have been incremental changes every single time. You know, they find out different things. Well, we better change this. Oh, well, this didn't quite work. We better change that. Of course, they had a failure last summer, last June, which Elon Musk blamed on his one of his suppliers giving him, you know, faulty struts that held tanks. However, you know, that you'd think would have been a pretty simple fix. It took them 6 months to fix it. And while they were fixing the struts, they just happened to tweak a few other things while they were there. But it did work pretty well on the next flight, the Orbcomm OG-2 flight in December, and that's the one that they flew back to Cape Canaveral after launch. So here's the track of the launch, time exposure, and then the time exposure of the landing coming back. that to...
Where did they land it at? Which, where at the Cape?
That was, used to be Complex 13, one of the old Atlas pads. All that had been cleared off. The blockhouse was already gone. SpaceX came out and knocked down the old pad and everything else and put in, it's like a 300-foot diameter concrete pad out there. And they're building two more nearby. And we'll talk about that in a second later. But that was pretty spectacular. I had a chance to be out there to watch, not on base, but immediately off base. And to watch the rocket take off, yeah, we're used to that. But, you know, we're sitting there, and the second, after it stages, you see the second stage going on, and then you see this first stage light, and it turns around and it starts coming back at you. And it was a little bit nerve-wracking to watch that rocket come back at us. And I happened to be, you know, I finally figured out that we were on the reverse azimuth of the launch, because it was on, it wasn't due east, it was a little bit north. It was like a 37-degree inclination or something like that. And I happened to be on the back azimuth, so it was not moving side to side. It was coming directly back at me. And my friends that were out there watching, they were like, yeah, it's coming right back at us, isn't it? You know, it was a little bit, it was nerve-wracking because I'm just not used to it. And the safety guys cleared everybody off base with the exception of the 700 or 800 people that are deemed mission essential, you know. The fire folks, the safety people, obviously the launch crews from SpaceX and things like that. But everybody else, the other 5,000 people that work out there, could not be on base during the landing attempt. So they cleared everybody off. In the future, you know, they'll probably gradually allow people to get out there and be a little bit closer to it. But only essential personnel were within anywhere like 4 miles of the landing pad. So it was fun to watch. You know, the sonic boom got there the same time as it landed, and everybody's like, oh, it blew up. But, you know, my friend had reminded me that, oh, we're going to hear a sonic boom as it comes back down and decelerates from hypersonic speed, which it was doing, you know, when it staged, to come all the way back to the pad. And it just so happened the sound got there at the same time, and a lot of people were freaking out. But, you know, he had warned me, and we're watching it, and we could see it just go behind the trees just as it landed. And it flared up a little bit, and then it got dark. I said, oh, the engine shut off. And then the sonic boom got there. But there was no big flash like you've seen on the ones where they've landed on the barge, you know, when it fell over and exploded. So I said, it actually worked. I was really surprised that it did, but, you know, it's amazing. And then they took that same booster and fired it up again a month or so later, and it worked okay. I still want to know who's going to be the first person to fly on a used rocket, but who's it? SES, who's one of the biggest satellite operators, said they've signed up to buy a used rocket when they get more of them. I mean, they're going to try reusing these in the future as well, or several of them, but they've only gotten the one so far.
Did SES comment how much they were going to save on that?
That information hadn't been released. In the old days, there were a couple of satellite companies that would always take that chance. Eutelsat was known for being, they were on the first flight of the Atlas 3, first flight of the Atlas 5, first flight of the Delta 4, because they got a good deal. SES is probably going to get a pretty good rate for flying a used rocket. And then, you know, if it works, well, that's going to change all the economics of the launch industry, I'm sure. And, of course, they're trying to fly this week. They're on the schedule again for tomorrow. We'll see if they can do it. Falcon 9 switched over to using super chilled locks. And they're lowering the temperature of the locks and of the RP-1 as well. Because the colder it is, the more dense it is, the more fuel they can pack into the vehicle. The problem is that the ground support equipment has a hard time keeping up with keeping the locks at that super chilled temperature. Once you pump it into the tank, obviously it starts warming up and boiling off. And the GSC has to do an awful lot of chilling to keep that locks at that low temperature and keep pumping it back into the rocket, keeping it filled up. And we're hearing the rumors that that's what caused these last couple of launch delays for them, because they're tanking at like L minus 30 minutes, which is very, very late in the launch count to be moving your cryogenics onto a vehicle. And they got enough to get ready for one launch attempt, like right at the opening of the window. So we're thinking that they fuel at L minus 30 minutes, and they can go to maybe you know, they've got maybe 40 minutes worth of super chilled locks on board before the temperature starts to get too high and they don't get the performance they need out of the vehicle. So, you know, they're going to have to make some more changes. If they launch tomorrow, I'll be surprised. But even with the 90-minute window, they got to L minus 2 minutes and they said, well, we can't recycle. So, you know, normally if you had that much time, if you're fueling it L minus 30 minutes, you think you could drain it off entirely and refill it and still have another 40 minutes of window left. But they didn't do that. So we think that there's some, they're still dancing around some difficulties with the super chill locks. All right, so Falcon's going to be flying the Falcon Heavy off of 39A now that they've got the license from NASA to do that. And that's going to be the basically a three-stack Falcon 9, 27 engines on board. And it's going to be the most highest payload weight of any U.S. booster since like a Saturn V. It's going to carry more than SLS if they can get it to work properly. Like I said, they've been saying they're going to fly since 2013. Here we are in 2016. They're not on the schedule now until November. But that'll be very interesting. It cross-feeds propellants from the two side boosters into the core vehicle so that when they stage the core vehicle, it's almost fully fueled. And they're planning to bring back at least both of the side boosters for land landings at Landing Complex 1, the former Complex 13. So we're going to see two vehicles coming back at the same time, and maybe the core as well a couple minutes later. So, you know, if you thought people were nervous before, wait till you have three rockets under thrust coming back. Of course, SpaceX has a contract with NASA using their Dragon vehicle and sending that up to the International Space Station to deliver cargoes. They're converting that to be an astronaut carrier as well, to be a crewed vehicle. And the interesting thing they want to do here, they're going to want to get rid of parachutes and use, if they need the escape rockets, they've got those on boost, but if they don't need those, they're planning to do a propulsive landing without parachutes. And, you know, that would be back on the Cape as well. So you re-enter and you come quite a ways back and pretty close to Earth before you fire up your landing rockets to land with a nice hovering touchdown at zero velocity after coming back from Mach 24 in orbit. So Elon says he can do it. If anybody can, he probably can. I mean, he whips his troops pretty hard, and he's got a lot of very smart people working for him. So I wouldn't put it past him. But if, in my opinion, if he says they're going to do this in 2018, I would say 2024. Because, you know, he's a very optimistic guy. Boeing's been building the CST-100. They've got a contract with NASA as well to deliver crews and cargoes to the International Space Station. This is the one that's being built in one of the former orbiter processing facilities at KSC. Looks like an Apollo with the service module on it. Very similar, except obviously this is a lot bigger. It can carry up to 7 astronauts. They're going to fly them on Atlas V's, and they've taken the Atlas V used to fly from a clean pad where they just rolled out a small mobile service structure with the rocket. Now they're finishing building this crew access tower, which is going to be permanently out at Complex 41. It's going to have a nice white room and everything to allow the crew to get on board the Starliner Lincoln County. One of the other ones that NASA gave a contract to recently is Sierra Nevada. With their Dream Chaser. The interesting thing about this is it's a lifting body, and it's very similar to the NASA X-38 crew return vehicle, which in turn was very similar to a Russian lifting body that they built back in the late 80s and early 90s. It's going to launch on an Atlas V. They have two versions, a crewed version, which is way in the future, but the contract they have with NASA now is for a cargo version. Notice there's no windows. It's all autonomous, going to carry up cargo inside as well as have a cargo module attached to the back. This is the portion that backs in and docks with the space station, offload the cargo, reload it with the kinds of samples and gear that you want to bring back at a relatively low G loading, and it glides back to a landing. It only gets down to about 2.5 or 3 Gs on the on the return, so it's a lot easier than pulling 6 to 7 to 9 Gs on a capsule that's doing a ballistic reentry. So the idea is that you can bring back those biological life science samples that can't take the high Gs to a nice land landing. You just, you know, grease it in on the shuttle runway, the SLF. And then in the future, they want to fly a crew version where they can take out, and I forget if that's 5 or 7 or 5, 6 in that neighborhood. Astronauts up to the space station again. On top of an Atlas V, and probably eventually on top of a Vulcan rocket as well. Some of the smaller vehicles we're going to see out of the Cape. The Minotaur is a derived from a Peacekeeper ICBM. It's a four-stage autopropelled vehicle. We're going to be flying the operationally responsive space mission number 5, which is a geosynchronous surveillance satellite next year. Interesting thing about this is it's going to fly from Complex 46 at the Cape, which is at 28 degrees north. This is a geosynchronous monitoring satellite. All the geosynchronous satellites are at the equator, right? They're at zero inclination. This vehicle is going to have a fifth stage on it, which is going to be used, going to fire almost like at a 45 degree angle to take out the 28 degrees inclination and fire sideways so that it reduces the orbital inclination back down to zero. And, you know, normally they can, you know, the only other place they might fly this from is Kwajalein, but that's like 6 degrees off the equator. But it's very expensive to take a 90-foot tall solid propellant rocket out to Kwajalein, which only has pads for some relatively small vehicles. So they said, well, let's come to Florida, fly from 46, which was built for vehicles of just this size, and then they add the fifth stage, which takes down the inclination to zero. So next May, hopefully, we'll see that. We're working on getting the pad recertified and rebuilt to cover this mission. And then there's about 30 or so Peacekeeper missiles left over that could be used for other missions in the future. We're hoping that Orbital 18K are going to be able to, they'll get permission to sell these commercially, so we might see some of these flying in the future. Blue Origin, okay, so there's, you know, one of the big things in space these days is being a billionaire and deciding to start your own space program. So Blue Origin is owned by Jeff Bezos, who owns Amazon, made his money there. He decided he wanted to get into the space business. You probably heard that he's been flying some space tourism vehicles out of West Texas. Suborbital out there. This is going to be his orbital vehicle. He's gotten permission, he got the license from the Air Force for Complex 36 out of the Cape. He's building a orbital launcher that's going to use LOX methane in the first stage with the BE-4 engine, which is the same ones that ULA and, are going to buy from Blue Origin to put on the Vulcan rocket. And the second stage is a BE-3, which is a LOX liquid oxygen to liquid hydrogen, which is one of the first new liquid hydrogen fueled engines in the U.S. inventory, or will be when they get that operational. The BE-3 is the one he's been using on his suborbital space tourism vehicle. They're going to adapt it some more for high altitude starts and fly it on their orbital vehicle as the second stage. Because obviously LOX hydrogen, if you don't know, is a very high performance, high specific impulse second stage. Right now, the U.S. has the RL-10 derivative engine, which is Centaur, and that's on the Atlas V and the Delta IV, and it's going to be the upper stage engine on the Space Launch System as well for the foreseeable future. So, you know, the U.S. has had one LOX hydrogen engine since 1961 or 62 when the Centaur was developed. We just keep tweaking it and tweaking it. So this is going to be the first new LOX hydrogen engine in production here in the U.S., hopefully in the future. They're pretty close to the vest when it, sorry, close to the vest. When it comes to, you know, what their vehicle's going to look like, we're working with them. I can tell you that, well, with the non-disclosure agreements, I can say the vehicle's going to be very large. We're talking on the order of over 300 feet tall, and some of the designs I've seen, the diameter is over 25 feet, which is, you know, you're talking like a very large rocket. They haven't given it a name yet, at least as far as I know. It is going to plan to fly back their first stage. You can barely see, you know, in this artist's conception, that he's got landing legs on it. So they want to, they're going to have a slot on the Cape as well. With, they're going to put a big, you know, bullseye of concrete out there as well and fly their first stage back and try and reuse those as well. Because right now, you know, Bezos and Musk are duking it out on Twitter saying, you know, I flew the first reusable rocket, you know. So that's going to continue, and we'll see how that turns out. But both of them are very interested in reusing rockets because they see the economic benefits of that.
Let me ask you a question from your viewpoint. How is ULA going to live in that environment? They're like a put-together company anyway. They didn't really exist. I don't think they still really exist, but are they going to be able to survive?
I think so. I mean, they're making a lot of changes to try and become more competitive and get their costs down. And, you know, they're selling their services on launch. They're in like 101 consecutive successful launches with government and commercial payloads. You know, and SpaceX is up to, they got to, what, 13 before they had a failure. So, you know, ULA is very expensive, but they're working very hard to bring their costs down. If they get the Vulcan vehicle and start reusing those booster engines, I think their costs are going to become competitive with SpaceX as well. We're going to start seeing a bunch of small launch vehicles. This one's called Firefly. These folks are based in Austin, Texas. This vehicle is only about, I think it's only about 80 feet high or so. It's a lot of composite construction. Interesting thing about this one is they use a plugged aerospike engine on the first stage. So that's going to be a cool one to see. Again, no fins. You know, these people have no consideration for model rocket scalability whatsoever. And another one without fins, Rocket Lab and their Electron. Rocket Lab is a New Zealand company. They formed a Rocket Lab USA division so they can, you know, not have to worry about ITAR considerations here. It's another one that's an all-composite construction vehicle. And I forget, you know, 9 or 11 relatively small motors on the first stage cluster. So that's another one that's about 500-pound payload or thereabouts to low Earth orbit.
Very, very clever fuel pump system on that.
Yes, yes. It's going to be a very interesting vehicle. And they're very close to being ready to fly. I think they're going to fly from New Zealand next year. If you talk to Matt Steele, he's working for Alaska Aerospace Corporation. They're sending the range tracking system and command destruct system from Alaska down to New Zealand to help support that launch. And then we're talking to them about flying this vehicle from somewhere on the Cape, probably Complex 46 or maybe one of the other ones if the Air Force wants to ditch some more excess assets with us. Horizontal launch vehicles, a bunch of wacky stuff coming along that we may or may not see. Some of them are pretty far along, actually. Strato Launch, you probably heard about this. They're building the world's largest aircraft. And it's in construction at Scale Composites out in Mojave, California. Bigger wingspan than, you know, the Spruce Goose or 747s by quite a bit. The idea is it's got six engines, twin fuselage. It's going to carry up a booster that's basically a Delta II class rocket underneath. And right now, you know, I'm not sure where they are. At first, they said they were going to build a liquid propellant vehicle, and then they said they're going to build a solid propellant booster to hang underneath this. So it'd be, you know, a super giant Pegasus kind of thing with a solid propellant. Remains to be seen. We know they're building the aircraft, but we have not been talking to
them. You know who's
building
the rocket? Because
well, that's the thing. For a while, it was Orbital ATK, and then they were going to buy engines. At first, they were going to buy engines from SpaceX, and then SpaceX says, wait a minute, we're not going to sell our competitors rocket motors. So we'll see. I'm not sure. X-Core is building the Lynx, building both a suborbital version, which is going to be either a space tourism vehicle, takes off under rocket power, does a zoom climb up to you know, the 100-kilometer mark, gives you a couple of minutes of microgravity, and then glides back to a landing on a shuttle runway. They're also going to build a version that has a small booster on top, so when you get up to the top of your 100 kilometers or so, you can shoot off an upper stage and send CubeSats and MicroSats into orbit from there. They're pretty far along. They're supposed to be coming to the shuttle runway to fly from there. We're talking about building them a hangar as well. Generation Orbit, they're taking a business class Gulfstream, and then strapping a solid propelled vehicle underneath it and be able to shoot off CubeSat kind of launches kind of vehicles into orbit. So you're talking, you know, 20 pounds into low Earth orbit or so. Virgin Galactic, who has never has a shortage of great ideas and good PR, they painted up a 747. They're going to be flying something they call Launcher One, which is another small satellite launcher, can put a couple hundred pounds into orbit. Remember back, we had somebody that wants to launch 4,000 satellites, somebody else that wants to launch a 700 satellite constellation. Virgin Galactic says, well, we can put one of those satellites up for, you know, a couple million bucks on this Launcher One that they carry up underneath the 747. So if the market's there, that'd be the perfect kind of vehicle to do the onesies, twosies that you need to replace a broken satellite every couple of months, or, you know, every year or two when something fails. So there's a few potential ones there, and I think Virgin Galactic, you know, they've got the PR machine to make things happen. I think Launcher One, you'll see in my opinion, you'll see an orbital launcher from Virgin Galactic a lot sooner than you're going to see Space Shuttle 2 take space tourists up on zero gravity flights. Because, you know, they've been doing that for, what, since 2004? And they're still working on it. And it hasn't quite worked out for them. Other horizontal ones you might see, DARPA, you know, Defense Advanced Research Projects Administration, is doing a lot of different concepts. They're talking about launching something off the top of a 747. This one was called ASA, some sort of a quick reaction time, low-cost launch vehicle underneath an F-15. That one just got canceled because, unfortunately, the contract they gave to the solid motor manufacturer, and DARPA throws money at a lot of high-risk projects, and this was one of them. But the propellant formulation that came out of this ALASA project was good. I mean, it had very high specific impulse. The problem was it blew up. So, they'd ignite the motors and they would explode. And there are not many F-15 pilots that want to be that close to exploding rocket motors, so they canceled that program. Okay. They are also doing some concepts where they use a biz jet to carry up something. Starfighters is F-104s, they've got a fleet of F-104 Starfighter jets that they use for air shows as well as for space tourism kinds of things where they'll zoom up to Mach 2 and 80,000 feet and give you a couple of, you know, minutes of microgravity. They're talking about putting a small sounding rocket under the wing of the F-104, releasing it at Mach 2 at altitude and getting some CubeSat into orbit from there.
Have they any talk about the DARPA experimental rocket plane coming out of Kennedy?
The XS-1?
Yeah.
Yeah, we're talking to all three of the competitors there, Northrop Grumman,
Mastin,
and Boeing. And XS-1 is they're trying to build a reusable booster that flies back, and it's got a second stage that goes on into orbit. That's probably about 3 or 4 years down the road. Just to finish up, a couple other wacky things we might see. Orbital ATK recently won a new contract from the DOD for a EELV class vehicle. And we haven't seen any pictures of it, but we can think it's going to be something similar to what their Liberty project was, where they take a shuttle SRB, another one of those five-segment SRBs, same that goes on the Space Launch System, processed in the same building in the VAB at KSC, you know, use the same kind of infrastructure that was there for shuttle, and then they're going to put a second stage on it. We're not sure yet. I haven't seen what that second stage is going to be, whether it's going to be another solid or whether they're going to, you know, are they going to buy Blue Origin upper stage engines? Who knows? But they do have a study contract for about 100 and some million from DOD to build a vehicle, which would be another, not a replacement, but an addition to, you know, Atlas V's and Falcon 9's. Bigelow, the hotel entrepreneur, is still talking about building inflatable space stations as well. You're going to see some of those fly maybe in the next couple of years. A little company called Moon Express, they're building a secondary payload on other vehicles to do a lunar landing as part of the Google Lunar X Prize. Moon Express vehicle is about a meter in diameter. take pictures, and they win the Google Lunar X Prize by landing on the moon, taking a picture, and hopping 500 meters or a kilometer or something like that, taking more pictures, and then they win $10 million. Of course, it costs more than that to get there, but you know, they see, Moon Express sees this as a precursor to bringing back samples from the moon or from asteroidal bodies as well. So we might see some of those in the future. And thank you very much. Don't forget to support our sponsors, CosmicVest.com. I got cards here because my wife is starting to sell space-related vests and neckties. So if you want to look as sharp as some folks do, she'd be happy to do a custom-made vest for you. And, of course, we are Go Florida. That's the big PR thing that the state of Florida do. You know, take a look at that. If you're ever in the area for a launch, make sure you look up on wearegoflorida.com because we have pre-launch parties, and they give out free food and T-shirts and, you know, trinkets and tchotchkes and stuff like that. So if you want to come for that. All right. Any questions? I'm trying to hit my 60 minutes entirely here.
I didn't have dinner. I wasn't going to make it through.
Right.
You didn't get dinner?
No. I was in the museum. I was the very last person out.
Peter made us get a Subway first before he talked. That's as far as we got.
I saw that. I just looked at her. I should have, if I had known, because I actually, then when I saw that, I was about to upload my phone. And I thought, wasn't I my precious little flash drive? So I have to do a contract.
There's a lot of
drawings. I'm not backing them. So now I've got a printout of it.
And then they would take it to you guys, and they're already sort of.
No, I can picture the world there. Once you get close, it's like, you know, the nose is.
The nose is not too lazy. Yeah, the nose is like a part of the nose.
Doing a foam with, you know, just a shroud, basically.
Yeah, it's a conical with.
Yeah, which actually matched the museum photo, which I think had a slip-on covering on it, which has a straight taper. Which was okay, because I didn't want to do anything complicated.
Right.
It was a build-up foam structure.
Yeah, and then
it's not
never a surprise they had
no surprise.
The blueprint
Richard Murrow's. Of the earlier?
Of your version.
Of my version, okay. That's
yeah.
Right.
And,
nice talk.
Yeah, and then again, I think I mentioned in the comment that there's a NASA technical report server buried in there. There is a report on the canceled wind tunnel report on Falcon that gives the geometry laid out. But yeah, I looked at that. Then I also looked at the thing where somebody had uploaded my old drawing, which was based on.
Yeah, I don't know. That's like a sidetrack, something that was unrelated.
Yeah, somebody was like cranky about somebody's drawing or something. It's like, I get all this crap about my drawing. I was like, well, it was my only source. And then I think that version is actually one of the stories.
What's going on?
So yeah, they had four.
I think the F-104 had like four
along.
Yeah, the F-102 had the whole family sort of stuck on. There's a Super Falcon hiding underneath.
One's IR and then one's
Is this on anything?
Yeah.
Should I be trying to hot things here? I didn't sign up with anything. Maybe I should sneak up and bend it or grab a book.
I thought we were all supposed to go into the other side.
Are you made this from Jason?
Yeah, Cornelius is next door.
Oh.
Was this the vendor?
Was the vendor presentation last night? When he called us up to the podium?
It was more formal. Gary had something he didn't want to talk about until today.
I'm here starting.
Is three samples? Is that one?
I don't know. It's on mine.
I just got
three samples. Anybody want?
When does the vending room shut down?
We have free samples.
I think it was supposed to have been at 7.
The vendor room or the vending room?
The vendor room, because I have things there.
Well, I don't think it's shut down. I just don't think it's
summer. There's still people there now.
There are probably still some people
there. Yeah, I just don't want to have stuff left there if they shut down.
I don't think we're going to lock the room up.
I have yet to see one fly.
This is 10:30, so my last pass.